That's really what I want to talk about today, which is rebuilding a 60-40 portfolio with smart alternatives. So I'm just going to leave this on the screen. This is the obvious disclaimer about being general advice in nature, and I'll explain a little bit about what I'm going to be talking about today. Obviously, the 60-40 portfolio, which broadly means 60% growth, 40% bonds, defensive investments, and it's been the traditional approach to portfolio construction for many, many decades. And there's been a lot of talk about that model being broken effectively. Our view, and so this spoiler alert, it's not, but we think there's a better way to do it. With that, we're going to start the history lesson. So in front of you there, it's a reference to modern portfolio theory, which came about due to the man up on the screen, Harry Markowitz, who back in the early 1950s, he was studying portfolio construction, and it was the first time anyone from an academic perspective, and he wrote this up in the Journal of Finance, anyone applied the concept of both return and risk together, and more so focusing on the risk component of portfolios. And so it was a paper called Portfolio Selection. And what's in front of you now in that circle is effectively all the combinations of securities that he had at his fingertips to analyse, and the various combinations fitting inside the circle would give you various expected returns, so on the axis marked D, and volatility, so risk on the other axis as well. And really what he was trying to get at here is you have various expected returns for different levels of risk, and investors should want to maximise their expected returns while minimising their volatility or their risk level. So all this fed into the next part of the model, which was the efficient frontier, which talked a lot about diversification and mixing assets. And what the efficient frontier really is about is basically saying it's a combination, so it's the optimized, a combination of assets in a portfolio such that you can't increase your expected return without increasing risk and vice versa. Where it all led, and this isn't anything really earth-shattering, that diversification is key. So it's anything that diversification is all about lowering risk. I see it all the time where portfolios aren't really diversified. People think they are. They own a NASDAQ ETF, they own an Australian technology ETF and the FANGs ETF and think they've got three funds, so they must be really well diversified. Well, guess what? They all went very pear-shaped at the same time, all exposed to the same risk there. So after all of this, after all the maths, trust the world of finance to put it to work. And this is really what underpinned the birth of the 60-40 portfolios. So after all of this maths, it started to be applied to different asset classes and indices. And really at the time, you had two asset classes, US stocks, US bonds. And when looking at the analysis and on that efficient frontier, basically, to get a moderate level of volatility, take a bit of risk, but not excessive amounts of risk, so around that 10 to 12% per annum mark, the maths spat out, well, you should own 60% in stocks and 40% in bonds. But in the last couple of years, there's been a lot of talk about the predicted death of the 60-40 portfolio. And why there was all of that talk was twofold. One is, the 60 component, the stocks, went through the roof. You had interest rates at zero effectively everywhere, and valuations, especially in that kind of tech area, went ballistic. So arguably not a great environment from a valuation perspective. And the 40% component, rates are at zero. So effectively the bonds, traditional bonds, not all, and I'll go into some of the not all in a while, but the traditional bond part of a portfolio was yielding nothing and guaranteeing a loss. So With that in mind, the media, the financial press was awash with talk about the death of the 60-40 portfolio. And what came about in 2022 was potentially a death blow for it, which was obviously markets sold off heavily And what you see at the end, it's circled on the chart there, 2022, the dark blue is the Aussie, traditional Aussie bond index, largely government bonds. The lighter blue is global bonds, which is largely US government debt. We're down 10 and 15% in a year. And so when equity markets were falling, the whole theory of diversification was equities fall, bonds go up, and vice versa. And that obviously didn't work. But our view is that the 60-40 portfolio isn't dead. And part of that is because rates have increased. The quote up there on the screen is from David Swenson, who was the chief investment officer of the Yale Endowment Fund. So one of the most highly credentialed investment managers and endowment funds in the US. And he presided over that portfolio from 1985 through until 2021 when he died. And so to my point about traditional 60-40 portfolios hadn't moved on, but the world has changed a lot. And so just some observations there since the 1950s. Well, in bond markets. So at the time, it was all about US debt. Well, now the corporate bond market is enormous. Emerging market bonds, that's an enormous asset class, both in terms of what debt emerging market countries raise in US dollars, but also in their own currencies. Big trend towards privatization. So governments privatizing infrastructure and that opportunity set for investors is there. The end of the gold standard in the 1970s with currencies not having to be backed by physical gold has had a profound effect. Private market assets, they're not just publicly traded assets. And the impact of climate change, obviously the biggest risk of our time or focus of our time. So I just mentioned the Yale model, referred to that. The Future Fund, Australia's own sovereign wealth fund, wrote a paper and released a paper in December last year, which is actually well worth a read. It really talks a lot about the same stuff, about their outlook for traditional beta, so traditional markets, not being particularly strong anymore and needing to look outside of that. Well, our argument is that with the rise of ETFs and the democratization of in investment markets, individual investors can actually access similar things to what these institutional investors are doing within their own portfolios. And that's what I want to talk about for the remainder of the presentation. So, in terms of the highlights from the paper from the Future Fund and what it means for investment portfolios, they broke it down into these seven areas. So first being, alpha is more important than ever. So alpha is basically fund manager speak for outperformance. And what they're saying is we've got pretty dicey economic conditions. We've got sticky inflation that's pretty high. We've got rates that are higher than they've been for a long time. Maybe the total return outlook isn't great from just traditional indexes, so we need to seek something above and beyond that. And so more regional differentiation. So looking at various countries, both in terms of their equity markets or their bond markets, and going into a bit more granularity in there. Again, back to that diversification theme of more correlation caution. And I think what they're talking about with the correlation caution is, well, if inflation stays really elevated, what we saw in 22, which was when equity markets sold off and so did bond markets, well, if inflation's here and rates have to push higher, that's a headwind for equities, but the bond mathematics is basically rates go up, prices fall. So that's another challenge. So, and I just alluded to the higher inflation as well. Being more dynamic, actually having to pivot portfolios more. We don't have the tailwind of continually sliding rates over many, many decades supporting markets. Foreign currency is no longer be defensive. And so in Australia, what historically has been the case is if markets are very weak, so too the Aussie dollar. Well, in a period of higher inflation, higher commodity prices, that may not hold going forward. And the big one there as well being decarbonisation and what that actually means with this clean energy transition, the risks to portfolios, but also the opportunities in there as well. So with those areas, these are the levers that were activated. So first was allocating more to private equity. Second was focusing on liquidity and dynamic asset allocation. So obviously ETFs allow for those things like asset allocation because you can easily move between asset classes. Having detailed levers for, so DM developed markets, EM emerging markets, a broader currency basket, adding to infrastructure. We write about that all the time, about the appeal of infrastructure as an asset class. And then adding gold, commodities, tangibles, alternatives, other asset classes into the mix as well. I actually want to do just a bit of a deeper dive on a few other areas, and so that they discussed in there. So alternative approaches and exposures for this new world. And their approach to, I guess, what a lot of people have come along here to talk about here about today, which is equity markets. So the approach to listed equities, and the quote there from their report, the enhanced beta sleeve systematically harvests equity risk premia through exposure to factors that compensate for undiversifiable risk. Now, I won't ask anyone to translate that, but what that actually means, so the enhanced beta sleeve, they're actually just talking about factors like quality or value. They're talking about what we write about all the time. Smart beta is basically any index methodology that's different to just the regular market cap weight by size. And so I've actually got a couple of examples in there. So quality investing. So that's the lever for this environment. You've got alpha being more important than ever, more regional differentiation, a more dynamic approach. This is the actual performance of the qual ETF against the MSCI world since its inception about 8.5 years ago. And that quality exposure has outperformed the regular market index on an after-fees basis by 2.6% per annum. And another example is equal weighting. So it's not a particular factor like quality or value, but another approach to equity investing that's been shown to add value. And so MVW is our Australian equal weight ETF. It is, broadly speaking, it's about the top 90 or 100 stocks equally weighted. There's more to it than that. If you look at the ASX 200, and a lot of people in the room, I would guess, would own an ASX 200 or 300 tracking index fund, and you'd think, oh, wow, super well diversified across 200 or 300 companies. Well, we'd contend that's not the case because 10 stocks are half the market and two-thirds of the market is in banks and resources. So as a way of getting brilliant diversification in one trade, which is the whole concept of an ETF, we'd say the regular index is deeply flawed. From extracting more alpha, like the Future Fund is talking about, this fund has been around for now 9 years and 2 months. And over that time since inception, on an after-fees basis, it's done 1.6% per annum over the ASX 200, and the fee's only 0.35. And so this is a great example. It's consistent with the academic literature on equal weighting, which is it should outperform over long periods of time. China A-shares. So this is looking at that regional differentiation, correlation, so diversification as well. And so I've got to fund their China New Economy. Well, the three things I want to leave you with on China A-shares, and this isn't VanEck saying, hey, you should put all your equities into China A-shares, being the mainland China stocks. Point one, China has the second largest financial market, so share market in the world, and according to the World Bank and the IMF, come 2024, it'll be the largest economy in the world. And most Australian investors will have no exposure to China A-shares. So our point here is that the zero isn't the answer. There's a good reason to consider allocating to China A-shares. And two of them are on this screen. So the chart on the left going up and down is a correlation of the China A-shares market against just the broad S&P 500 and the MSCI world, so US stocks and global stocks. And what you can see is probably on average, it's been about 0.1, 0.2. So you'd actually say it's uncorrelated. In more recent times, it's gone negative as developed market equities have zigged, China equities have zagged. So from a correlation, a diversification perspective, blending in a portfolio, this behaves differently to what are the traditional approaches to portfolio construction. And another cool area, this is an area that the Future Fund allocates to is emerging market bonds. And again, regional differentiation, more dynamic approach, being having that correlation caution there. What we would say about emerging markets, again, is there's a strong case for it. On the left there is looking at debt to GDP. The black line is the emerging market average, and the purple line is developed markets. So on the left, what that's saying is emerging markets have got way less debt than developed markets. The chart on the right of the slide is rate hikes. Developed markets in the dark blue line, and emerging markets the light blue line. If I had more time, I'd ask for some comments on it and some observations, but I'll just give it away, which is the light blue line starts hiking a lot earlier than developed markets. And just a bit of a proof point as well, so this is a performance table. So we've got EBND on the top line, and then you've got the benchmarks. It's an active fund, so first point is it's outperformed the emerging market bond index by about 4.5% per annum since we launched it in Australia. But at the bottom, we've got the Australian bond index and the global bond index. And the reason I make that point is that is pretty much that 40% bucket in the 60-40 portfolio. And it's been carved up big time. And the final thing on the investment side I'll just leave you with, we saw the chart at the start, which was to the point of why we thought, why there was speculation about the 60-40 model being dead, and then the bond market falls. Well, that's fixed rate bonds. If we actually look at how they have performed during various rate hiking cycles, and so we've got a few there, so the most recent one on the far right. Fixed rate bonds, the Aussie bond index obviously fell off a cliff, but FLOT and SUB D last year were positive because their floating rate. Rates going up is actually a good thing. It increases the yield, but you don't suffer the bond price falls in there as well. To wrap it all up, we started basically with an efficient frontier. We've actually, all the things I've spoken about, we mapped it. We did the efficient frontier, and what you'll find, those areas like China shares and emerging market bonds, quality infrastructure, gold, they're all pretty close to that line, which is a good thing as well. So in our view, the 60-40 portfolio is far from dead, and we are so pleased that tools for investors are available in a similar way to how institutional investors can get exposures to these particular areas as well.